Hello friends, I'm Paulshinn from the YouTube channel that's making Model A's cool again. This is Gandalf the Green Coupe, an early 1930 Deluxe Ford Model A Coupe, and you probably thought I forgot about this car. Okay, I admit, I kind of did. But today we're back on it. Gandalf already runs and drives fantastic, but it doesn't have the best radiator in it, so I get to swap that out again, and some mice got to the wiring harness while it was sitting outside years ago, and I didn't know about that, but I know now. So it's getting a brand new wiring harness with turn signals. It's gonna be even better than it was before. Way back in November of 2022, you saw Model T and I replace the radiator in this car with what we thought was gonna be the radiator that was gonna be in it for the rest of its life. In fact, I'll just put a link to that video right down here. But turns out, that was not the right radiator for this car. So what I did is I took the radiator that was in this car and I took it to my radiator guy and had it re-cored. So it is even better than new and it's gonna go back in this car. Step one, need to drain the coolant out of the radiator and engine block. The way to do that is right down here at the bottom of the lower hose. See that little petcock thing down there? Make that out. What we're gonna do is open that. All the water's gonna drain out. Now the nice thing is Gandalf has the engine pan. So all I gotta do is put this at the back of the engine pan and all the coolant should go into that. I have an adjustable wrench. They always fit. All right, let me turn this. Ooh, that was really stiff. All right, here it comes. There we go. That more or less is making it into the pan. Well, my apologies ahead of time for those of you who need a restroom break. Go ahead and take care of that. Nothing really exciting is going to happen for the next couple seconds. Now that all the coolant is gone from the cooling system, I'm going to make the electrical system dead by taking the fuse out of the fuse holder and putting that aside. Now, theoretically, when I pull the wires out of the lights and all that stuff, I shouldn't get any sparks or anything. So now to get ready to pull the radiator, I'm going to take the flying chicken off the front. It takes this funny looking Torx thing. Should just come right out like that. Next step, we got to take these hood rods loose. So take your made in USA half inch wrench. We'll loosen these up and we'll pull these off on each side. This is so we can pull the hood. I'll just pull this loose. There we go. Out you go. All right, let's get the other side. Slide the hood over very carefully. Again, use your made in USA half inch wrench. Take these loose, pop that off. Okay, put the hood back down. Now I'm gonna go to the other side and I'm gonna take the upper hose loose. Now, if you have the stock clamps, you'll just need a made in USA slotted screwdriver. Take the clamps loose. I'll take both loose because I'm going to end up sliding this around quite a bit. So I want to take it loose off the radiator neck and off of the water outlet on the head as well. Get these totally loose and then off the hose completely. Now for hood removal, the radiator rods are loose. I'm going to go ahead and put the side of the hood down. I have my assistant over there. I'm going to lift up on your side ever so slightly. Okay, now I'm going to pull the radiator forward and pull that pin out of there. Now we're both going to work together. I'm going to pull the pin out the back. Now it's loose. Maybe. Okay, now that it's loose in the front and the back, up we go and forward like this. Okay, now we're going to set it down. We're going to tilt and on the army blanket. Hood removed. Next step, take your made in USA screwdriver and get the clamps off the lower hose. Next step is to pull the wiring out of the conduits to the headlights, and you don't even need tools, you just use your texting things here. Okay, so next step is to pull the wires from the horn. So take out your made in USA screwdriver, take the one single screw off the cover here. Remove the cover. Here's what the inside of the horn looks like. The wires just tuck into little connectors on the bottom. I'll show you here. They're located right here. If you can see, this is where they tuck in right there. See? You just pull those out just like that.
Done.
Now pull the wires out from the conduits here. I'm gonna pull the conduits out, like so. Headlight wiring. I'm gonna take these little pins out here, like so. These are the stock type of headlight connectors. Done. And again, we pulled the fuse out, so the electrical system's dead, so we don't have to worry about sparks. Just remove this. Done. Same thing on hitchhiker side. We'll just take these wires out of the little keeper here. Pull the wires through, conduit out, done. Next step is to remove the four screws that hold the radiator shell onto the radiator itself. Take your American-made screwdriver. Out they come. These are the ones with the square nuts. The square nuts are captive, so theoretically you shouldn't need a wrench on the backside. The bottom one down here is awful close to the fender, so you need your Made in USA stubby screwdriver to get this screw out. All the hardware loose, the wires out, the radiator shell just lifts right off. Piece of cake. With the shell off, you can easily see the hardware that keeps the radiator attached to the car. So all I gotta do is pull these cotter pins, 9/16, take these nuts off, the springs and all that, and the radiator will shimmy out. Now with all the hardware out, I can just kind of walk the radiator out. And out she comes. I'll take this outside, make a mess out there. While the radiator's out, this is a perfect chance to get to all this stuff in the front of the engine, the front cross member and all that. Get this all cleaned up, looking better. Chances are if you've driven your car at all, there's probably some dirt in here. So now's the time, make it all pretty. I've had to be very careful about how I film in here right now because there's all the stuff that fixed my house sitting over here and all around the car. As you notice, things in the shop got kind of tight. I have advice for you. If you do anything with a contractor and the name of the business ends with "and son," request the father. To make it easier to put the new radiator in, I'm just gonna glue these rubber pads in place just so they don't move around, because it's hard enough as it is to get the holes to line up with all the hardware. So just give myself a little bit of a head start on getting these to stay in place. There we go. Let that dry. And in the morning, we'll put the new radiator in. What do you say you and I go look at the sunset?
Yeah, that sounds nice.
Good morning. It is a great new day. Time to get back on Gandalf the Green Coupe. We got to get this record radiator in the car. Maybe even get it buttoned up today. Who knows? I glued these two rubber pads down last night with some silicone. They are in place now. They're not going to move around. That'll make it way easier to put the new radiator in. All right, finally, time to put the freshly recored radiator in. I'm going to carefully lower this into position, avoiding the fan and everything behind it that's pointy. I'm going to put the tab on the driver's side in place first. Just wiggle that in and then skew the radiator over slightly towards the back of the car. Slide the hitchhiker side in. Carefully jiggle to line the holes up, sliding ever so slightly. Once they line up, I'll go under the car, slide the hardware up, reach around, do the contortion thing, put the nuts on. Welcome back to my shop, where safety is the highest priority. So the hardware goes like this. The bolt comes in from the bottom. It has a little hole for a cotter pin, like that. Spring goes on top. Castle nut goes on top like that, cotter pin, so. Easy peasy. Spring, castle nut. Is it threading? Can you tell? Let me know if it's threading. It feels like it. Okay, let's call that side good. Let's do the other side. You can actually see the hole on this side. This is good. I see light coming through. All right, spring, castle nut. Is it threading? Is it going? I can't see the top. Yeah, it feels like it. All right. Let's get some tools. For this part, I like to use my super long extension and a wobble socket on the end here, so that makes it easier to get to the bolt down here. It's about the only way I can figure out how to get to these. I'm pretty much just gonna put that there. I'm just gonna hold it with this, and I'm just gonna tighten it initially until I feel the spring start to kind of compress. I have no idea where I'm gonna end up because, you know, you have to feel for the castle nut to start, you know, going down below the ends of the threads of the bolt, then you know you can hit the cotter pin hole. So I just get it about where it feels about right. I haven't even seen it yet. How's it look? Is it all right? Okay. I'll pull that off, get my wobble out of there. Move over to the other side. All right, here we go. I'm just gonna get this to where it feels like. There we go. Scratching the paint. Sorry. All right. I'm just gonna get it now to where it feels like the bolt is coming up through the top of the castle nut. Feels about right, like that. Okay, now I will come up top and start trying to line up for the cotter pin holes. Now I'm just gonna rotate until I can see a cotter pin hole come through the slots in the castle nut. Oop, right there. Same thing over here. Just gonna hold on to this and go until I see cotter pin hole right there. Good enough. Grab a new cotter pin. By the way, fellas, always use a new cotter pin. These things are cheap. It's very cheap insurance to use new cotter pins. And grab your made in USA pliers and grab the end of it. Swing it around over the top. Like so. Push the other one over the side. Like so. Get it out of the way so it doesn't stab you later. Although you're probably already blood brothers with your car several times over, there's no sense tempting it to do it again. Same thing on driver's side, new cotter pin, bend the tab over the top. If you're from one of the European countries, this is the hitchhiker side. Okay, a little more bend on that. Yeah, there we go, done. Before you put the radiator shell back on the car, this would be a good time to replace this cloth stuff around it, but we'll just pretend we didn't see that. Carefully slide the radiator shell over. Done. Looking good. Let's get some hardware. Now, although I'm not going to put my hose clamps and all that on yet, I am going to put the hose on and at least get the upper hose to kind of hold this. Now, here's a little trivia for you. On a 1930 Ford Model A like this one, the hinge pin is exactly 30 inches long. Didn't know that, did you? So if I use my Made in USA tape measure and I measure this out from the end of this to the end of this to be just a little over 30 inches, I'll be pretty close. So I can at least get this sort of kind of close. All right, that's about how it's gonna look about there. Obviously this is gonna change when we put the hood on. We're gonna have to pull that out and put it back in. So I'm not tightening anything up. I just wanna get a look at everything, make sure it all kind of fits where it's supposed to. I'm gonna start getting my hoses ready to go on at this point. Not tighten anything yet, just fitting everything, that's it. Then I'm gonna put all the hardware in for the radiator shell. We'll be good. Now's the time where I get to start reinstalling the 1024 screws with the funny square nuts. I'd attach the radiator shell to the radiator. Hopefully this just goes real easy. Use my Made in USA screwdriver. Now it's time to attach the hoses. Let's get this wire out of the way here. And we'll finagle the lower hose first. That one seems to be the one that fights me the most usually. And it's fighting now, of course. There we go. All right, now just gingerly finagle it into place. There we go. Get it on there as much as we can. Make sure there's enough meat to bite onto for the clamps. Make sure that the petcock to drain it is pointing straight down. Now these hoses have been on here for a little while, so they're gonna seal just fine with these clamps. But here's a pro tip. If you have new radiator hoses on your Model A, use the worm gear style of hose clamps first. Put those on there, get it good and tight to where it doesn't leak. Leave them on there for like a week or two. Then if you want, you can take these off and use the correct reproduction looking error correct type clamps on there, because these don't really have quite enough bite to seal brand new hoses real well. But there's a little tip, just use the worm gear style on there and get the hoses used to sealing first, then switch to these clamps and then they won't drip. Now, I'm not gonna tighten the upper hose clamps yet. I want these to stay loose because remember, we still gotta get the hood on. There's gonna be some adjustment there. After all that's done, then I'll tighten these. The next step would normally be to go ahead and put the wiring in for the lights on the hitchhiker side here. And that's what these little tabs down here are for. Come in, I'll show you what I'm talking about. Now see, if I wasn't about to change the whole wiring harness in this car, see these little tabs right here? I would be putting the wire here inside the tabs and then bending these over to hold the wire in. And then I would be feeding it up through here underneath and out the conduit to the headlight. However, I am going to be putting a new wiring harness. And as you can see, this was a brand new wiring harness when I installed this probably 5-6 years ago. This harness got put in the same time this engine got swapped in. But unfortunately, this sat outside at Bob's house for a couple of years. And what I did not know when I brought it back to my house that I have now recently discovered is mice got into the wiring harness somewhere over there. Now this new wiring harness is junk. So I have another new wiring harness for it with turn signals. What I'm gonna do right now is I'm gonna set these radiator support rods so that I can get the hood in, but offer a little bit of support. So I'm gonna run the nuts back a little bit and leave me enough throw and get these on, or I should have all the way back. I'm gonna set it about where I'm gonna want it, which is right about there, according to my US made tape measure. But see, I have not pulled the front ones back yet, so I can still move the radiator out to about 30 and a half, a little more than 30 and a half, 30 and three quarter. So now I can get the hood in, but I've still got support on this radiator. It's not just gonna be flopping here. This is helping and the rods are helping to make sure we don't jack this up before I get the hood installed. So you're probably wondering, why am I wearing a hood like a hat? Well, Model T's not home yet and I wanna get this done and it's already late afternoon. So if Derek can do it, I can do it. Oh boy, I don't recommend this. This is hard. Boy, this is dumb. This is why women live longer than men. This is exactly why. There we go. All right, I got the rear end. Get the front end. Wholeheartedly do not recommend this. Ah, got it. Now what do? Run the nuts forward. Hold it. Okay, me set one side of the hood up like this. I'll grab the other one so I don't damage the car. Oh, did I get it? Maybe. Might have. Done. That was easy. This is my redneck way of setting this gap properly. So what I do is push the hood all the way back, push the radiator all the way back into this. Now I'm going to tighten up these nuts in the front ones, just by hand. That's it. I'm not going to tighten them with the wrench. Just get them like that. That leaves me just a little wiggle room, whatever the crush is on that split washer. I now have that much wiggle room and I can pull it forward. So I've got just a little tiny bit of a gap now, just a little tiny bit. So now I'll take the rear nuts and run those forward. And then I'll end up tightening the rear ones with my American-made half-inch wrench. And then what I'm gonna do after this, I'm gonna kind of adjust the hood. You can get a little bit of a adjustment one way or the other at a hood to get things to line up straight. I'll show you how to do that. It's kind of like a fine adjustment. It's not a coarse adjustment, but It'll be enough where you can get your gaps to look pretty close. As long as your frame's not bent, your gaps should look pretty straight. All right. Now I'm gonna close the hood, both sides. I'm gonna look at the gaps. My rear hood gap over here on hitchhiker side, it's a little bit wide here, a little bit narrow over there, which means the radiator top needs to come this way towards this side. So what I'll do is I'll run this up again so I can get under and access both of the nuts at the same time. So I need to bring the top of the radiator that way just a little bit, which means I'm gonna back off the back nut over here. And this doesn't take a whole lot. A little bit goes a long way here. Remember, you don't want to put a lot of stress on this radiator either. You don't want to crack the solder joints in it. Run this back a little more. Okay, now what I'm going to do, I'm going to take the front nut loose on this side. This will allow me to skew the top of the radiator that way. And then just repeat until the lines are straight. Simple. I'll check out my gaps both sides. Darn near perfect. If anything, I might bring the bottom of the radiator out just a little bit on this side because this line here is just a tiny bit tight. But looking across the hood, that line is perfect. That's a perfect gap right there. In case you're wondering how to skew the bottom of the radiator out, just a skosh, well, gently, just tap, 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 that's all. Don't do this at home. Well, actually, yeah, do it at home. That's the place to do it, not on the side of the road. Oh, perfect. This line's perfect now. Check this out. Look at that. Perfect. Now is the time to go ahead and tighten the upper hose clamps because I don't think I'm going to be having to make any more adjustments on the hood. If I do, I can always just loosen these up a little bit. But now's the time to make sure there's plenty of neck here. There is. Let's get these tightened up. Now again, I've had these hoses on here for probably a year or so. But if you were putting brand new hoses on, remember to use the worm type hose clamp first. Get the hoses trained. Then put the Model A correct looking ones on. This is my method for using a worm type hose clamp to train the hose. So see, I put the Model A hose clamp on just below it. So once I get the hose trained, then I can go ahead and pull that worm clamp off and just slide the Model A clamp up, tighten it, done. And we're finally up to the fun part. We get to see if there's any leaks. So what I like to do first is fill up using distilled water. I'm not gonna put any antifreeze in it yet, because I just want to see if there's leaks for right now. I can drain some of this out and replace about half of this with some antifreeze. So I'll have half antifreeze and half distilled water eventually, if there's no leaks. Let's go get another one. Filled it just about to the top. You can just see the liquid just below the vent right there. Now we just wait. We didn't have to wait long. I've already got a leak right here. It's like the upper hose. Need to get that tighter. Tighten this clamp down just a little bit more. Let's see. All right. Well, is there any moisture down here? No, nothing there. Let's check the lower hose. No, no moisture. No? Wow. That totally worked out. Yeah, we'll just keep an eye on this for an hour or so and see if we get any drips.
1 hour later.
Still the same amount of water, and an hour has gone by, so I think we're pretty good. You want to know how I know an hour has gone by? Because of this new clock. Check it out. From ModelATshirts.com. I'll put it right down here. That has a 1931 Ford Model A wide bed bud cab pickup on the clock. How cool is that? You know what I really like about this clock and why this is welcome in my shop? The clock I had previous to this one, every time the second hammer moved, it'd go click, click, click. And if it was dead quiet in the shop and you hear click, 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 it drives you crazy. This clock here from modelat-shirts.com, dead quiet. Takes a single AA battery, lasts for what, a year or two? No noise, dead quiet. Very welcome addition to the shop. Modelat-shirts.com, check it out. Not just t-shirts, not just bags, clocks too, and they're quiet. All right, no leaks. Let's figure out what we're doing next. Confirmed, no leaks. So we can get on to the last step of this part anyway, minus electrical, of course, which is remounting the flying chicken. Get this sort of straight where it's supposed to go. All right, flying chicken mounted, done. So that's it, radiator is installed. Good job, Model T. Time to crack a nice unwoke. Ah, RC Cola. That first sip is always the best. Here, I'll let you have first sip.
Oh, you don't have to have it, let me.
I'm a nice guy. Don't tell anybody. So anyway, that is how to swap a radiator again in a Ford Model A. Now, as you notice, there's a little bit of electrical left to do, no big deal. That's the next video. I'm gonna show how to put a wiring harness in a Model A again. So remember, drive it like you know how to fix it. Thank you for watching. I'll catch you on the next video.